Aloha. I'm Carlie Wiener, your Marine Science Gal on this Tuesday, December 3rd. And for our monthly December spot, we are going to be sending you our best holiday fishes as we speak with three amazing scientists about their important fish research. With us now is Alan Andrews. Dr. Andrews works as a research fisheries biologist with the Life History Program at NOAA Fisheries. He has spent over 20 years doing research in California and worked with numerous species all across the world. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Carly. It's great to be here.
I can't wait to share what you do. So let's start from the beginning before we even share with our listeners your methods. What do you think about fish age, and do you think about how old a fish is when you sit down to eat it?
Yeah, that's one of the things I kind of like to introduce when I talk with people about what I do, is to get them to think about how these fish grow, how long they can live, and why do we even care about how long these fish can live? And I find that in most cases, people really don't think about it. They equate the age of fish to maybe a goldfish that they had for 10 years. And they think pretty much every fish probably lives about 10 years old. Some understand it a little more than others, but that's sort of the segue into the work that I do, is asking people, basically, you know, how old do you think fish live?
Well, first off, if you had a goldfish that lasted 10 years, you have the magic touch. So how long do fish live, and why do we care how old fish are?
Well, I can get into that. Starting off with the goldfish, the longest lived goldfish is like 43 years. They've actually had a goldfish live that long. So there's a number of species that I've been working on lately. I've been working on the opaka-paka. And the original estimates for this fish were somewhere on the order of 5 or 18 years old for their maximum age, but they really didn't know how long it lived. And the work that I've been doing basically answered that question, and it turns out they can get to be over 40 years old.
Wow, that is an old living fish.
Yes.
And so how do you know that opaka-paka can be up to 40 years old?
Yeah, so that's the thing that I like to share. And one of the techniques that I use to answer that question is I use a method called bomb radiocarbon dating. And this has to do with finding the atmospheric signal that was created by nuclear testing in the atmosphere in the 50s and 60s. That signal, that radiocarbon signal, was sent throughout the world in the atmosphere, and then it worked its way into the ocean. That signal can be found in the fish ear bone if they were alive during that time. So if the fish was, like, say, the 43-year-old opaka-paka that I have, its birthday was somewhere in the mid-early 60s, and I could tie that date very specifically to that rise of radiocarbon from the testing of bombs during that time.
That is amazing. It's so incredible that you do that. And how do you extract this information from an ear, something as small as an ear bone?
Yeah, so the ear bones, and some people may not know what this is, it's called an otolith. That's the fish ear bone. They're kind of a special bone. They're more like a mineral. It's more, they don't get resorbed. So the otolith grows continuously through the life of the fish. And so the stuff that's in the middle, the core of the otolith, the deepest buried part, is birthday stuff. So I have to go in, and first of all, you can actually section these otoliths just like a tree. Like if you cut a tree, you can count growth zones in the tree. Same thing with the fish ear bone or the otolith. You can section the otolith, count the growth zones, and get an estimate of age. But with trees, we know the growth zones are one per year. But with fish, how do we know? So we have to validate that. So the bomb radiocarbon dating has to do with I take a little tiny dentist drill bit and I tap out the very center of the otolith. And then we measure that very, very small quantity of material for radiocarbon. So basically that center, the core of the otolith, represents the marine chemistry at the time it was born. And then we link that to records that are found in coral cores. So the coral grows, you know, they grow bands every year, and there are solid records that go back in time that can tell us what the marine chemistry was like at that time. And so the measurement that we make from the otolith core can be correlated to the coral record, and that gives us a very specific age.
That is very precise work. You must have very good precision. And how many species have you done this method for? Does it work on everyone, or certain species are better than others?
Yeah, certain species are better than others. The more shallow living species in the mixed layer, the upper part of the ocean, deep water tends to have the bomb radiocarbon signals tends to be in the upper parts of the ocean. So so these fish like, you know, the snappers and the groupers, they work quite well. I've done quite a bit of work with the rockfishes along the west coast. Deep sea fishes like orange roughy, we have to do other techniques in order to come up with validated ages for them. But it's working quite well here. We're finishing up the kala, which is the blue-spined unicorn fish, the hapu'upu'u, which is the Hawaiian grouper. Those I'll probably be published in a paper this next year. The opakapaka paper is already published. Working on the onaga right now. We're getting age estimates on the order of 50 years old for them, but I need to validate it, so that's a work in progress.
Wow. And what implications does this have for how we fish and manage our fisheries? I mean, this has got to change the way we look at fish age and what we do with
right.
the fish.
Right. The important part of this is what when you consider how long the fish lives, if they live to be 30 or 40 or 50 years old, then that means each fish has a much greater potential to contribute back to the population. And so it's fairly complicated. I don't do the stock assessment side of things, which basically these numbers are put into a big system where they do an assessment of the health of the population, and then they make management decisions based on those numbers. So this the changes in longevity will change how they rate the fishery and how many fish we can take. For sustainability, by the way. That's sort of the target is sustainability of the fishery.
So this is very important information for managers to have so they can better assess, you know, what to do with the fish. Is this only happening for Hawaii, or is this type of research happening in other locations?
It is happening in other locations. I'm expanding my work to the Great Barrier Reef. I'm doing work on a couple of species there. And throughout the Indo-Pacific, I've got some other projects started. But I have colleagues in Seattle with the Alaska Fisheries Science Center. Craig Castell does this kind of work with the rockfishes and some of the other species of that region. In Europe, there's some other people doing work. I'm actually working with an Italian colleague right now on the European hake. So we're kind of spreading around and seeing if we can get, you know, answer some of these important questions.
That's amazing. And is there any favorite location or interesting species that you've worked with that, you know, has kind of stuck with you?
I guess I like the charismatic reef species, like the bumphead parrotfish and the humphead wrasse. I mean, they're just amazing animals, huge. They used to get really huge. They're not so many of the real big ones around anymore. They're an amazing animal.
And how old do they get?
It wasn't the largest, and it was 45 years old. And that was the bumphead parrotfish from the Great Barrier Reef.
Wow, that's amazing. Next time I go snorkeling, I'm going to think all the fish are older than I am. And so with this work continuing on a global scale, do you have plans to move on to new species for Hawaii, or what's next for your research in particular?
Yeah, in particular, I suppose, well, like I said, the European hake is a little bit of an offshoot. But continuing through the bottom fishes for Hawaii, we have, you know, Gendai is on the list. I'm finishing up the hapu'upu'u, which is the Hawaiian grouper. But we're also expanding to the Western Pacific. We want to do this kind of work in Guam and in the CNMI region. There's no bomb radiocarbon record there yet, but I'm pursuing documenting the bomb radiocarbon signal with a coral core that I sampled from some Japanese researchers. I went to Okinawa a couple of months ago, and we sampled the coral core for radiocarbon. So we're trying to get that work done so that we can apply that technique there as well.
And do you have any concerns or hopes for the future of fisheries that maybe this work can contribute to?
I can only hope that it makes things on the sustainable side as opposed to over-exploitation.
And can this work be applied to other species besides fish? I know you mentioned you're using coral cores as well.
Yeah, it can be applied to anything that has a conserved skeletal structure. I finished some work on the white abalone in California. It's an endangered species. It's the first marine invertebrate to actually be listed as an endangered species. And so we use the shell to track the bomb radiocarbon signal from places off of Southern California.
And I have to ask, how long do they live?
They get to be on the order of 30 years old.
Wow, that's amazing. And is there any last messages about your research you would like to share for today?
No, just think about what you eat before you eat it.
Well, I can't wait to see some of your papers and some of this age dating. I think it's really important. Thank you for your time. It's been fascinating. We'll take a quick traffic break, and when we come back, we will be talking with Dr. Ivor Williams.
I- 760 KGU.
Part of the Wall Street Business Network.